Hey, we've been talking about it, and now it's finally here. At about 12:10 each day this week, we are going to feature this guy. His name is Andy Oak, and he calls himself the First Ladies Man. Hi, Andy. Welcome to KFGO in Fargo.
Hey there. Nice to be here with you all today.
Okay, let's start here. How do you become the First Ladies Man, and what does that mean?
Well, first of all, to Jack, I want to say, it sounds like you've got a heck of a fishing derby coming up in between football and baseball, so that should keep you guys busy for a while. The prizes sounded incredible.
Yep.
I want to fly out for that.
Yeah, we always have fun stuff going on up here, Andy. You come out anytime to Fargo. We'll show you a good time.
That's great. And that's part of how I get to be the First Ladies Man, is I like to travel and I like unique and interesting stories. I had the good fortune of being part of an amazing staff at C-SPAN, and they were doing a series called First Ladies Influence and Image. And I was contracted to be the series producer, the field producer that went to every location for the entire series. So that's every museum, library, church, home, school, general store, cemetery, birthplace, plantation, farm, train station, every First Lady, Martha Washington through then Michelle Obama. And now I continue my travels and my research for Melania Trump to add to the list.
What does the research include? What are you looking for that we don't already know?
Well, what we, the American public and the world, typically know about these women is their time during the White House as it relates to their presidential husbands, and that's what makes them the First Ladies. But what I wanted to find out was what they were like as young girls, as young women, as girlfriends, as aunts, as sisters, grandmothers, widows. They are real people that live, love, laugh, lose, win. They have lives outside of the White House and outside of their presidential husbands. And who are these women, these young women, that marry these men that would become president? And going to each and every one of these locations, I found artifacts, letters, journals, photo albums, physical items, dresses, clothes, houses, that made these women really step out of the pages of history books and become these real women that I wanted to get to know. And passing it along, I find that so many people think they know about First Ladies, and that's not even all of them. You know, before the project, I couldn't name every First Lady in the United States, and at most of my speeches and events, a lot of people can't either. And I get it. We don't know these women beyond their title, but when you get to know them as personally as I did and then share their stories, the public becomes aware of how real these women are and what an integral part they were in the formation and the continued success of this country, that it's almost an endless supply of information.
So, Andy, Jack asked me something interesting before we went on the air. Has he ever met any of the First Ladies? And I went, well, that's a great question. Have you met any of the First Ladies?
I have. Before the project, I grew up outside of Washington, D.C. I'm from Rockville, Maryland, originally. I've traveled a lot for work, but I stayed local. I live in Maryland still and went to University of Maryland here in Maryland. So I've had access to the Smithsonian and access to the White House and access to Washington, D.C. beyond just an eighth grade trip or maybe a summer trip or vacation or so. And I interviewed Laura Bush back in 2006 related to a malaria story that I'd done in South Africa and Mozambique. And when I was a little kid, I accidentally ran across Betty Ford getting out of a limo. And there's a neat picture of me on that day in 1976, little towhead, tough skin clad Andy Oak outside of Betty Ford's limousine. And I snapped a picture of her. So those are the two that I've met. For the most part, for the series, while the series was going on, the First Ladies were being interviewed somewhere while I was in their hometown or I was at their museum or library, their husband's museum or library, doing the research.
Well, so knowing what you know, is there one that you wish you could meet or could have met?
That's a great question, Jack. And people do ask me, you know, stuff like that all the time, who my favorite in this is. They really are. I mean, I cannot stress enough how important they've been to this country. And we all know what this country means to the modern world, the outcomes of World War One, the outcomes of World War Two, global economy, Apple computers, McDonald's, Coca-Cola, Harley-Davidson. The list goes on and on and on. Man on the moon. I mean, we just can keep going and keep going. But none of it would happen because none of it would have been America if George Washington had married any other woman than Martha Dandridge Custis. And George Washington is her second husband. So to make all this happen, she had to first marry her first husband, then he had to die when he did so they could meet, so she could meet George, and all these things that we go back in time and play sort of Back to the Future with, and rearrange the puzzle pieces, the chess pieces. I mean, we could do that with any of us. We could do that with me. If my parents hadn't met at University of Maryland, there'd be no First Ladies, man. Right. But my last name isn't Washington, and my parents didn't start America. Well, to facilitate that, and if Martha wasn't able to do that for her husband and facilitate the wealth and social standing that she gave to George Washington, he would not have had the time or the resources to go out and start the revolution and do what he did to start America. So all that being said, I'd really, really like to hang out with Lou Hoover.
With who?
With Lou Hoover? I thought you were going to say Martha after all of that.
I know. We're going to do it with Lou Hoover. Lou Hoover is one of the most fascinating 20th century first ladies. She's the first first lady to graduate with a geology degree from Stanford. She put herself through school in Stanford. She's the first woman in America to graduate with a geology degree. And she taught herself seven different languages, traveled around the world. She and her husband were multimillionaires by the age of 30. They're the first administration, Hoover's the first president, not to take a salary, followed by Kennedy and then now Trump. But reading her letters and seeing... She went out into the deserts of California with her father and sketched all their campsites and the animals and the flowers and the things. Her thirst for knowledge and exploration that led all the way through her entire life is infectious. And I think that she would be a really, really interesting person to cruise around with.
Huh. Could you keep up with her?
I could try. I did, I did all of the traveling for this was done by me alone. There was an excellent staff back in Washington D.C. that did the production and writing the shows and booking the guests and things like that. But when I went out on the road to do this, it was me and seven bags of gear. And I know from other television projects and things that a staff of somewhere between 5 and as many as 25 people would take a week to do what I had to do in a work day because we just didn't have the time and the budget on the project to hire local crews, hire local people. I couldn't even hire, a local high school kid to help me carry the seven bags of gear. And when I was done with the project, in a year and 2 months, that's how long it took us to do it, and we were actively shooting it as the series was on, so there was no wiggle room for missed flights, canceled flights, traffic jams, anything you can imagine. So by the end of this project, I needed prescription glasses, a shot of cortisone in my back, a shot of cortisone in my hip, and 2 rounds of Z-Pak for walking pneumonia. So I think I could keep up with Lou.
Wow. Hey, as far as first ladies and the privileged lives we imagine they live and certainly do, Martha Washington, if you don't mind me asking, what was a privileged life like for a first lady back in that day?
Sure. Well, Martha Washington was not from a poor family by any stretch of the imagination, but she was considerably lower in social standing than her first husband, Daniel Parke Custis. But she did have slaves. The family had slaves. They had a small plantation outside of Williamsburg. She was homeschooled, but most of these women, especially the early women, are educated to a higher standard. They come from families that just have the wherewithal to give their children as much as they can, to educate them as much as they can, as opposed to just sticking them right out in the field or sticking them in the family shop or this. And Martha Washington, at the age of 26, when she became a widow, she was basically one of the first female CEOs of a massive corporation. Her husband left her with 8,000 productive tobacco acres. She had about 4 or 5 times the Virginia state governor's salary in cash on hand in the form of silver at the time, and she owned a considerable amount of real estate. So the privilege that she would have had by just having parents that educated her beyond the normal means of boys or girls of the day would have put her in a position that she can manage this type of property and fortune for Washington and her. Because, I mean, think this too, that these women were doing these things before they could vote, before they could own land, before they could, I mean, they were basically, the mothers were in charge of keeping the family finances in order to pass along to the son. So they're doing all this, and they're these partners in our success and the creation of our world and our businesses without pay and without credit in many cases.
I remember when Laura Bush's response when President Bush made reference to, maybe it was that speech aboard the ship, a mission accomplished, and he said something about bring it on. In reference to if they want to fight, bring it on. And
yeah.
Laura Bush has reportedly have said, well, way to go, cowboy. And that just gave me a world of admiration for her. So, are the first ladies cheerleaders for their husbands?
They are. You know, their number one job, Jack, that's an excellent point, is whether conscious or subconscious, directly or indirectly, they are the PR team for their husband. We look at right now, Melania Trump's poll numbers approval rating are going up. And typically, first ladies poll higher than their husband. This is the thing to remember about all of them. They are unelected and unpaid, yet they are probably the most influential and powerful women in the world just by who they're married with and just by who they share a bed with and are partners with. So the information that they're privy to, all of them, Washington, going back to Washington again, George Washington said he couldn't think straight if his wife wasn't with him. So she traveled to nearly every 13 of the winter encampments during the Revolutionary War. Lady Bird Johnson, as soon as LBJ, even as powerful and as, I mean, that guy was tall, he was a real control freak, he would get out of his speeches and out of his public appearances, he would go right to Lady Bird and she would say, you didn't stand up straight here. You slurred this word. You did this. I mean, she had little notes and marked off. And there's audio recordings of those conferences that they would have. President Johnson and First Lady, Lady Bird Johnson. And he's just there saying, yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Good point, ma'am. Yes. I mean, so these women do coach and they do watch and they do lead these PR campaigns. If by nothing else, being a softer, kinder, gentler side of maybe a more divisive man like a President Trump, or a Calvin Coolidge, or a James Madison going even farther back. These women throw these parties, and when you say throw a party, you're not just, that can kind of, parties in Washington, D.C. and parties at the White House are not like Super Bowl parties. It's not just all, you know, is the nacho dip warm enough? Do we have enough chips? Is there enough ice? I mean, these women are politicking, and they're putting people in conversations with each other that are changing policy that changes the world. And they're basically choreographing this through these parties and through these hosting duties.
Well, we have a chance to talk to you every day this week, I understand.
Yeah.
And I'm thrilled about that. But before we let you go, and I hear music in the background telling us we're out of time, but just how tough was the Iron Orchid, Rosalynn Carter?
Well, she is a first lady that very quietly, almost in the same way as a Pat Nixon, she sat in on all of, most of the majority, whenever she could, the cabinet meeting with her husband. And she's the one that led the Peanut Brigade, the grassroots campaign that got her husband elected to governor and president. So she was a significant role. She, more so than almost any other first lady, it's hard to study Jimmy Carter without studying Rosalynn Carter. They're both from Plains, Georgia. They knew each other all through school. She was best friends with Jimmy's sister. Jimmy's mother watched Rosalynn Carter's father as an in-home nurse while he was dying. Their lives are so intertwined. And she was a quiet iron fist behind the scenes and ran a lot of things in that administration.
Andy Oak is the first ladies' man, and he'll be with us every day this week at around 12:10. You won't want to miss it. I feel like we could just do hours of radio with you, Andy. It's been fun. The first day under our belt. We'll talk to you again tomorrow. Do you have an idea of who you're going to bring to the radio tomorrow, Andy?
Well, I think we've set this up very nicely. So then what I want to do is I've got two volumes of my book. It's the 1700s and 1800s in volume one, 1900s and 2000s in volume two. So I want to focus on a couple of my favorite first ladies that you might not know or be on the tip of your tongue in Volume 1 and a couple in Volume 2. So I'm going to put those together and kind of surprise you tomorrow with some of these names. We've talked about Lou Hoover a little bit, but I want to talk about Helen Taft tomorrow, and I want to talk about Grace Coolidge tomorrow for sure.
It's a date. Thank you very much for joining us.
I'm looking forward to it, guys.
I'm going to share a little bit more about Andy on this podcast as well. If you want any links to his social media accounts, his websites, I'm going to put those at KFGO.com as well, and you can find them there. And we'll talk to Andy Oak, our first ladies' man, tomorrow on KFGO.